So I'll tell Plaisance there's just someone working up there.
You're alive and well. Don't keep me waiting now. What's in there? In that dark sarcophagus?
She's looking for the right expression. The dark sarcophagus? Yes, yes. How was it? Jama says, tell her how ghastly it was. You know it's what she wants to hear. No. Honestly, a dump. Nothing to see there. Just heaps of garbage. Someone should let the sunshine in. But what else did you find? Did anything survive? No, of course not. Have you located the entity? I talked to the entity you told me about. Her name is Neha, and she's a novelty dice maker. Novelty dice maker? Her eyes widen. Well, spit it out. Why does she need the dice? For some kind of sorcery? Perhaps they use the ankle bones of sheep. She's not a sorceress or some malicious entity. She's a businesswoman, like you. She looks perplexed. I don't understand. If it's not her, then where is the source of the doom? How did she explain the curse? Endurance says, before you say anything, ask yourself, is the woman really able to withstand the truth? Logic says, the narrative she's built herself, it does need tearing down. Okay, so these two do not agree. Drama says, to hell with it. Perchance you ought to just lie, sire? If I were to take majority rules, I would be lying. She said it's just capitalism. Bankruptcy is a quirk of our economic system. Wait, what? Her entire face goes white as a skull. Then the entire economic system is cursed? Indurin says, this woman's not healthy enough to withstand this level of stress. Only revolution can help you? This sun must be cleansed of immigrant labor. We live in a precarious world. I guess she's not going to believe me, or she's going to have some kind of nervous breakdown? I don't know. But, I mean, if she stops thinking there's a curse, then she could actually relax, I guess, eventually. It's true. We live in a precarious world. Nothing ever turns out right. You need to get used to chaos. Precarious world? Economy? She looks down at the pendant in her trembling hands. I understand what's going on here. You went in there, rummaged around, and accomplished nothing, and now you're telling me these intellectual things to cover up for it. It's okay. You don't have to. I was wrong to trust another person. I will manage this psychic calamity as I always have, alone, on my own. Yeah, I figured she wouldn't believe us. Volition says, as she has to, every day. Endurance says, maybe you were wrong. She's endured for at least 4 decades in this world. Level up. She tucks the pendant away in her blouse and concludes, thank you for nothing. Please, do buy some books, or be on your way. Rhetoric says, there was never any other way this could have gone. She's just too far gone into her own mind. I am sorry we had to disappoint you, ma'am. Kim turns to you. Can we go now? Alright. So, yeah, level up. I'm gonna save the point, though. We're starting to get some stuff done. Investigate the doomed commercial area. Complete. Now, while we're here, I want to take a look at this bullet again. Since apparently we can buy, look at it again. It's not an item. It's an interact. Yes. High chance. Alright, +4 for similar rifle on hand that we found down below. You're aware of the name of the antique rifle you found, plus one, and plus one said Encyclopedia said this came from a breech loader. Oh god, failure again? That's a horrible roll. You can't remember what happened last week, blah blah blah. Man, this is haunting us. Talk to Gart. Look for Ruby. Couldn't find her. So we can return to Suna now. Bring the offsite copy. And then that might help with these things. The bool, though. We can do that now. I'm gonna just turn off the music. So I don't get a content ID hit for the thing that plays out here. Alright. Let's give Gaston this bool. We might be done with him. Make him feel better. Too bad Renee wasn't around to see it, though, right? Oh, I can put the... I put that there and that there. Hello.
Oh, sorry, officer. What do you want?
Hey, Gaston. I found you a new boule. Gaston glumly stares at the shot put ball. Several seconds pass, then he speaks. It's too late now, officer. You got back too late. Renee is gone. The prick survived all the bullets, swords, and explosions just to die of a heart attack. Ironic, isn't it? Even his own bitter little heart couldn't stand him. Keep it. It's not even a real bull. He waves you away. Besides, it doesn't really matter now. I've never seen anyone else play petanque in Martinez. Alright. Well, that's that. Done. For lost bull. I can't retry him, he's dead. Right? Is there something...
Oh, sorry, officer. What do you want?
Nah. We can't retry him. So silly. Let's talk to Gart. This is right here. Ask him about the... ask him about the Doom commercial area.
Hey, was there something you needed?
I have to warn you, I may have discovered that Whirling is part of the doomed commercial area. What? He looks mildly startled. Why would you say that? We're at a completely different address from that whole thing. Reaction speed, so he says he knows of the doomed commercial area and its address. He said about this. Wait, so you know of the curse? Everyone knows of it. The Whirling is listed on the intercom outside as one of the businesses in Building B. You should get your wiring fixed. I tried to call and couldn't reach you. I've been working here for a long time, and that intercom has never been used by the Whirling. The Whirling was once the East Delta Pinball Arcade, which failed, though perhaps the Whirling will escape the curse. Does this look like part of a Doom commercial area? He makes a sweeping gesture. This pre-revolutionary tile work, these high ceilings, the nice rooms, well, most of the rooms. For 14 years, man. That's how long I've worked here. I kept this place up through hail and through sleet. Screw me if some doom ghost... He steadies his voice. Empathy says he's done a fine job, too. Though he's spoken of the place dismissively before, the hostel is actually very important to him. You really care about the whirling, huh? Yeah. It's slowly growing on me again. It's beautiful, in its own way. Especially for this neighborhood. I've been trying to keep it that way. Even if it is part of the damn doom commercial area. Aha! So you finally admit it. Yes, your police skills have delivered. I'm sure you got a commendation. Maybe even a promotion. For that, I doubt it. Who owns this place? Some real estate management company. They never come around here. Just collect money from afar. Honestly, I think some money laundering might be involved. And who named it Whirling in Rags? Well, it sure as hell wasn't a real estate company. It was you? Kim asks. You look surprised. What? It's a great name, I know. Cafeteria managers come up with great names, too. It's from a song. A song? Hail, Holy Queen by the Ateniers. Hail, Holy Queen of the Sea, he quotes. You're whirling in rags. You're vast and you're sad. Good pick, the lieutenant nods. What about those other cafeterias you manage? What about them? He shrugs. One is a basement dive frequented by chain-smoking communists. I can't tell you how sick I am of Krasmazov and Ignis Nilsson and all those old ghosts. Reaction Speed says he's hesitating, not sure if he should share this information with you. Encourage him. And the others? The other is a kebab cart. It's very successful in its way, but it's nothing like the Whirling. Well, good luck to you with this place, then. Luck has got nothing to do with it. He looks to where the hidden room is. I need to think about where I'm going to place those pinballs. I have a feeling they're going to help. Rhetoric says, against the doom, it's implied. So, if you didn't have anything else to tell me about my establishment, or can we, you know, wrap it up? Alright, so we finished that then. Look at that, we're getting stuff done. So this is done stuff, yeah. The Doomed Hostel. That was a quick one. Can I run upstairs? I mess with the mirror there still. Or, I mean, the door was locked, but maybe that's just during the day. I mean, night. Maybe it's just locked at night. Ah, true. Tool not in hand. Okay. Okay, let's try to fix at least this part of the room. Then I won't feel so guilty about trashing the place, right? I got an even chance. Use your chain cutters to fix the faucet. Stop steam from fogging up the mirror. Success! The faucet is quite terribly mangled, but you just might be able to twist its parts into place. You handle the chain cutters deftly, applying just enough pressure. The faucet regains a recognizable shape. Steam stops. Told you that you needed those chain cutters. Everything is connected. Everything has a purpose. The mirror begins to clear slowly without you having to wipe it. Alright. I've gotten rid of the expression already, so I don't think we need to do that. Put my default tool back in hand. Alright, so... I can't do the... This guy is not there. He's dead. Kim, I couldn't find. We do need to go visit her. Fell mural. I guess we'll return to that. Trash container I couldn't find. Unless it's this one, but there's nothing there. And the map wall, we can try again, I guess. I don't know what to do about the cockatoo. Warded door. Barbell we're not doing. Warded door. We got past that, though. Oh. I used the key, but it still shows up here. Alright, never mind. I used the key to get in. I didn't need to bash it down. Alright, never mind. Well, Klassje is right up here. Just keep going. So I can question her some more with now that Kim is with us. And, cool, you see all this stuff back there. What do you call it? We can tell her that we couldn't find her false fake ID in that buoy. Hello again.
Officer, it's a fine day for questions.
I found your buoy. It was empty, just seawater. Her eyes widen. Oh. Kim says, did you take the documents? No, of course not. As I said, it would have been too risky for me to use those documents anyway. My employer gave them to me. In truth, I should have destroyed them. Drama says, she doesn't seem to be lying. She's genuinely spooked by their disappearance. Perhaps the people who are after you took it. She thinks for a moment, then shrugs. They couldn't know where I put it. I'm absolutely sure I was not followed, and I've told no one but you. You mentioned seawater? I was worried I'd been too careless with the latch. The documents are probably... She waves her cigarette. Just washed away. We have concluded our autopsy and would like to ask questions about Lely. The lieutenant nods, taking out his notebook. Let's see, I wrote down the nickname Lelystad. He moves his finger across the page. Then tears one out and hands it to you. We have questions that might help solve some gaps in our field autopsy. I'm sure my colleague has a few of his own while I take notes. The young woman cranes her neck, trying to catch a glimpse of the page the lieutenant passed to you. On it is a list of autopsy observations recorded neatly in blue ink. Logic says everything left to be clarified is the column on the left. Alright, we have a bunch of questions. Where is Lelystad? The place, I mean. In Aranye, officer. It's a, I think, municipality is the term. A nowhere town there. Encyclopedia says, the Lelystad municipality has few boroughs and even fewer cities. It's made of agricultural plots near the border of Gotwald. Executive summary, cows, silos, and wheat. You are almost right, officer. The lieutenant shakes his head, like you just missed a shot in darts. That means his race was Occidental, not Mondial. I'll update the form. You were both from Aranye? Yes, we were compatriots. Did that bring you together? Kim asks. No, he was too old for that, and from another part of Aranyenric. I don't even understand his accent. What brought us together wasn't Aranye, it was bad habits. Rhetoric says, no love for Mother Aranye? But wasn't he a soldier? This could be worth pursuing. A military man, but not a patriot. No, he left the National Service after they taught him to do what he did on Seminine. He wasn't the flag-waving kind. He was the making-money-killing people kind. He was by no means a stupid man. She takes a long drag of her cigarette, then washes it down with coffee. A people person, a small platoon leader, certainly not a patriot. You don't seem much like a patriot yourself. Hmm, she hums. There was nothing on Monday. The old, old world is dead, and we both knew it. Maybe Aranye did bring us together, in loathing. I love Revachol, though. She looks around, the wind in her hair. I hope she loves me, too. How old was he, miss? He was 42. 42? Are you sure? Kim asks. I would have had him above 50. 42, incidentally, or maybe not so incidentally, is the answer to life, the universe, and everything. He had many scars that made him appear older, but no. The memory makes her smile. We even celebrated his birthday, like, some weeks ago. It was a funny 2 days. He had little reason to lie to me. Looks like you were right, officer. The lieutenant taps on his notebook once, as if assigning some kind of point. It's like he's giving me a pop quiz here. That healed my health by nothing, because I'm already full. Points are good, Indurin says. Have one, you old dog, before we all die. I don't want to die. I did not know this was a competition, Kim. It isn't. Police work is a cooperative sport. Physical instrument says there is no challenge without competition. There must be an opponent. Hand-eye coordination says this is clearly sports for him. Something like archery or darts? It's still about getting hits right and not missing. That's too pinball for me. I just like to get autopsies right on the first try. He makes another note. Where were we? Redrick says he's lying. His eye color? Blue. Light blue. They were like... She stops, her eyes half closed, and continues. Like little blue galaxies, you know. It was strange, seeing those eyes in his screwed-up face. Pardon the swearing, she takes a drag. I do him an injustice. He wasn't ugly, and he had a beautiful, soft voice. Very surprising, what with all the scarring. It was quite something, watching him speak. Kim asks, he had a combat wound on his chin and mouth? Yes, severe. She seems to enjoy the word. It made him look like half his face was cracking away in some strange smile. That and those eyes. Oh, yes, the lieutenant suddenly remembers. His hair, if you can remember. It was light brown, almost blonde. He darkened it with brilliantine, made it oily. Not nice to stroke. I couldn't convince him to leave it alone. He had a tattoo. What did it mean? Oh, she smiles. That. I don't want to lead her, so what did it represent? Do you know? It was a map of his life and the places he visited as a soldier. It was mostly for showing off the chicks, though. Showing off the chicks? How so? How? She leans back. Imagine him lying in bed, freakish musculature laid out on the sheets. Scarred, of course, tattooed. The sheets are dirty for some reason. Conceptualization says, is this Aranier lit? Is he lit? Yes, this is the very essence of Aranier lit. A moment's respite. Dark and hopeless as the struggle itself. She leans even further back to demonstrate. He's smoking and drinking, of course, and his chest and shoulders and arms are studded with stars. Tens, thousands of them. Maybe even... Or tens, hundreds of them. Maybe even thousands. And the woman goes like... She points at the air with her sharp, nailed finger, picking out an imaginary... Tattoo star. What was this, baby? And he says, she lowers her voice comically, that was too hardcore. Don't ask me about that. So she goes, okay, but what's this, baby? And she's like, saw some bad crap there. Killed some loincloths. And so it goes, star after star, port after port, third world country after third world country. And he's done horrible things in every single one of them. So you were the woman in this? Oh, yeah, she nods. Can you tell us precisely what these mean? Hand her the photo. No, thank you. She does not take it. I've seen enough of him dead. I can tell you what they meant without looking at them. She pours herself some coffee. We still have that photo, right? I have the feeling we gave it away. There's got to be something else. Kim says, go on. He was a blue-eyed boy with thick arms from a small town. He was also poor, and the government of Aranier needed some people killed, so they turned him into a grotesque killer for money. Level up. Test complete. For the tattoos. Oh, nice. And had that around for a while. He went to Killer Academy in Vredefort. Killer Academy? Then he killed some people on the Seminine Islands, and on other islands, too. All of the islands. After this, he came to Revachol and got killed himself. Not a very fun story. It is when you're high. It can be very exciting then. You have the tools to deal with it. It's not a very nice story to remember when you're sober. She smiles faintly. A change of topic? We ordered a toxicology report. Any idea what that will show us? A real rainbow splattering of pharmaceuticals, I bet. She grins. Barbiturates, amphetamine, sildenafil. How much does that toxicology report cost the police of Revachol? I can do it for half of that. Save you some money. Make some myself. Kim says, it's quite expensive, miss, but we'll manage without your help for now. Yeah, we don't want to have a potential suspect doing a toxicology of the murder victim. I think we're finished with this line of questioning. Kim, here's your notes. Test complete again. All right, the lieutenant puts the slip back in his notes and observes the young woman for a moment. Coolly, gracefully, she pours herself some more coffee. Visual calculus says, wait, stop. That man, bloated beyond all recognition, was 42? That's what she said, yes. Below the damage, the weeks of decomposition, all the swollen indignity of mortality. He was 42 years old? Where is this going? How old are you? That's where this is going. 45 liters of raw alcohol has left its disfigurements. What lies beneath, you wonder? Reaction speed says you could ask either one of them. Miss, how old do you think I am? Huh? She leans in closer. How old do I think you are? Rhetoric says she's buying time to formulate the best answer. I don't know. One? Two? I don't know what I'm supposed to say. How old is a newborn cop who doesn't remember he's a cop? I think I'm circa 45? You're not. Kim's squinting at you. Sure he is, she says. You know, age is just a number. Yes, but for him that number is higher than 45. Visual calculus says, wait, this requires scientific measurements. Bring it on, I'm not afraid of the truth. I have full morale right now. To the laboratorium. What? Date of birth generator. This takes 7 hours and 15 minutes and has no research bonus or minus. Your face looks like it's 58 and your body feels like it's 60. Your mind feels like it's lived for one day or 100, both longer than they ought to be, the day and the century. But for how long, then, has this thing attached to your sentience walked the planet's crust? Time to start racking those brains of yours, Elder One. When and where were you born? And here we have points. Let's unlock another. And I'll put that in there. Alright. And this thing has 29 minutes to go.
Yes?
Can't ask Kim about it. Well, I guess they both got involved.
Officer, it's a fine day for questions.
Devil woman? What? Her nails tap on a steel railing nervously, the sound of cold metal ringing under the wind. Kim, why have we not arrested her yet? There may be grounds here, at least for an extended detention. A little whimper. The young woman hears you. She's looking around. I don't think we should arrest her yet. Alright, we're done. We got done stuff. I like clearing it. Look at all the quests we've done. Oh my god. Oh, completed. Yeah. Active. We should return to Everard, I guess. And then go back to Suna. Can we run the number on the victim's armor? Call her back in a day. Ugh. Should we check on her again? I'm kind of liking, you know, completing quests. Here. Better watch that butt, Kim. Can I retry this guy? I'm trying to figure something out about his composure. Awesome. Nope, it's locked. It's all about money. Anything new here?
Again. I can't believe this shit.
Yes? What is it?
Anything new to say to Titus here?
Yes?
Oh, it's Kim.
The Copper NATO is back. What do you want?
I talked to Joyce. The merc you hanged. His friends are coming for you. Yeah? He doesn't seem worried. By friends, you mean his squad mates from Krennel? Eugene says wouldn't want to beat up his grandma. There's snickering in the room. Some of the men put their beers down. Yes, they're forming some kind of tribunal, and they're coming for you. Kim says, this is what happens if you take the law in your own hands. Other people start doing it, too. Let them come, Glenn yells across the cafeteria. The Hardy boys are right here. You heard the man. Right here. He points to the ground. We're armed. We got the whole district behind us, and Glenn is crazy. Alan says, yeah, a well-oiled murder machine. He punches Blondie on the shoulder. Physical Instrument says, the mood is on the rise. They're feeling confident, ready to punch out the whole Merc platoon. The mercenaries are armed with automatic weapons. We got weapons of our own. He cracks open his vest to give you a glimpse of his holster. We got Ister 50s, Zeal Gears. Glenn's got a knock cannon at home. Will they pierce ceramic armor? I guess we're gonna see, ain't we? Redrick says, that was an unsure phrasing. See what, that they don't? Yeah, like you've been up against ceramic armor. He takes a sip of beer to bide his time, then tries to get the last word in. You haven't even seen the whole suit, right? I've seen the whole thing and it didn't make him immortal. The Krennel is bad news, you know that, right? Pfft, a spray of beer. So are the local gangs. The Barmy Army and the Madre Scum. You been out there? Seen any around? Yeah. Where are they now, huh? Alan points south. Sent back to Madre in an airtight cargo crate. Kim says, these people are trained military professionals. Special forces, as you said. They're not a gang or a Barmy Army. No, they're not. They're uncoordinated and drunk. Don't forget, we're listening in on their communications. Their crap is way apart. Joyce said they've gone rogue. Nobody is controlling them. Big surprise, he mutters. They hire psycho scum, arm them to the teeth, and let them loose in the city. What do you think is going to happen? Do you know that a single Cerae's giant hornet can kill 40 bees a minute? Hell's that supposed to mean? You're the bees. They're the hornet. Eugene says, we're not bees. We're men. We're socialists. Easy, E. He's trying to phase you. He turns to you. What are you trying to do? Scare my men? Okay. What do you mean, okay? He jerks forward a bit. I'll be cutting you down right alongside them. Okay. I'll be on your side when... okay, you got one more gun on your side. Once I find mine... I don't want to bring that back again. I'll be on your side when they come. Yeah. Just try not to get in the way when the whoop-ass flies open. Redrick says, I think he meant a can of whoop-ass. Empathy says, beneath the whoop-assery, it's clear that he appreciates all the help he can get. Alright. Gonna try what was it called? The Cupri again? One more time. I don't know how long it takes to get this thing. The owner of the armored boots. Yes, I got the mercenary's name and a few biographical details. Are you ready? The lieutenant leans in to listen, notebook in hand. Shoot! The suit of armor was issued to an Aranier citizen named Ellis Cortanier. She spells it. Exact date of birth unknown. He was signed into Lelstad County Neonatal Care Unit on the 28th of February, 09. Neonatal Care Unit. He was found as a newborn in a leaf compactor near an abandoned farm. He spent 4 months in the neonatal unit, survived apparently, and was assigned to a foster family at 2. This is what the ICP knows about him. He was raised by foster parents, entered the Isbrand Military Academy in Redfort at 17, then served in Narnier's forces till he was honorably discharged in 41, just a year before the Seminese conflict. Then the armor followed him to Seminine, or at least I assumed it did. Assume it did, and that's it. There are no records of his employment in Krennel, or any of its other incarnations, or him even entering Revachol. In a leaf compactor. Any information on his foster parents? None, officer. Sorry. So he was found in a leaf compactor? It's a garden tool used to press leaves into these cubes. It's a detail the hospital had. The only detail in these files. So I thought it would be good for you to know. It is, Kim says. Thank you, Alice. So all we have to connect him to Krennel is the armor. Even that is a small miracle, Kim says. These organizations usually double-check their inventory. He leans closer and shouts, Thank you, Alice. Great work. No problem, Lieutenant. She sounds pleased. Authority says, A compliment from Lieutenant Katsuragi. Not bad. Well, we have his name and service record now. Complete. And we leveled up. Again. A name. This is very good. Ellis Cortenaire. He says to himself. Esprit de Corps says, Sometimes police work is about human dignity, about giving back names to anonymous victims. I'm glad the inquiry was helpful to your investigation, officer. Did you have any other questions? Nope. I'm done for now. Over and out. Blah, blah, blah. Okay, I got 2 more points. I'm going to hold on to them for now. Yeah, I'm tempted to get another... We'll see. I just got the second one, so I'm going to hold on to it for now. I'm tempted to open another thought cabinet. We can, right? This one? Yeah. No. Oh, wait. I stopped this? Wait. Oh, 12 minutes left. For regular law official. For that. I don't know if this started over. I don't know. Look at that. Getting stuff done. I love it. We don't have much. We still need our gun. Help sooner, and then this should lead to all this stuff. Determine where the shot came from. I don't know why in the boardwalk. Find the murder weapon. We might need to level up hand-eye coordination to just try again. Oh, I need to check with Everett. That'll be next episode. Yeah, next episode, yeah. Going to Everett to let him know we mailed the signatures out. And then going to help Suna with their project. That's next episode. Looking forward to it. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time. And always, seek adventure.